You know, when we started the entire discussion at the summit, we managed to gather insights around different industries as well. And with that, we actually now move forward to another pertinent topic wherein we are focusing around the marine resilience. I do believe that when we're talking about building marine resilience, we're talking about getting to the basics, protecting nature and securing the needs of the people. And that also is the theme of our next chat or the next discussion, as you may put it, because we've got two amazing speakers for joining us, and both in their own dynamic capacities are doing so much. And I think it'll be absolutely amazing to actually gather the insights. On one hand, we have Afroz Shah, who's a lawyer, ocean lover, and UN Environment's champion of the earth. In fact, he's someone who's tackling marine litter by cleaning rivers, beaches, ocean, and mangroves for the past 315 weeks. So we've got someone who's actually doing it on the ground. We managed to witness that in the kind of work that he's done over the last many weeks as well. And we also have with us none other than Shloka Nath, Head Sustainability and Special Projects at Tata Trusts and Executive Director, India Climate Collaborative, Vice President, Bombay Natural History as well. In fact, in this role, she leads the organization's climate, energy and environment work, implementing and funding sustainable and scalable solutions that help both people and nature thrive through India. So as you can notice, both of our speakers are doing some groundbreaking work, which is why it will be amazing to hear from them directly. So I hope all of you are eagerly looking forward to this session that's about to begin right here, right now.
Hi, Afroz. It's great to finally meet you in person. I've heard so much about you, of course, through the amazing work that you've been doing, cleaning up our beaches and rivers. And so I'm really excited to talk to you today.
Hi, Shloka. It's my pleasure as well. After seeing what you do at Tata Trust and other organizations, it's a pleasure to meet young people like this, you know, and take the conversation forward.
Thanks, Afroz. Well, actually, I wanted to sort of kick off our conversation with perhaps, you know, the first question for you. I really would love to know a little bit more about your journey, you know, as a citizen, how you sort of really came to do the work that you're doing, you know, cleaning up the beaches. The Versova beach cleanup that you did, of course, is now world famous. Yes. You even received an award from the UN for it. And maybe, you know, as you take us through that journey of what drove you to do what you're doing, perhaps you can sort of talk a little bit about the need that we have today in India as a nation to build a really circular economy that's dynamic and resilient and really progressive, and what that looks like for you.
Before Shloka, I say something on what my work is, I must preface my answer by saying that we are too many on this planet. 7 billion, this planet yeah. Can't hold it. That's number one. Number two, we talk a lot and we do a little, you know. After working at the ground of six years, we see all that. And the third very important thing is there is a complete disconnect between each one of us and Mother Nature. These three factors are in the background when we do any work. Having said that, you see, my beach cleanup is misunderstood most of the time, Shloka, I must tell you. People think cleaning beaches means clean beaches. I must tell you all that we get people there to understand what the problem is. We humans are problem solvers, Shloka. So if you get them near the problem, they start taking efforts. And as I always say to people, all of us, you know, Shloka, wear dual hats. One hat is your profession which you pursue. I'm a lawyer, at the court we pursue. You work at Tata Trust, you do that. And then we wear an individual hat as a species versus another species. So the fact that we exist vis-a-vis a whale, a shark, a turtle, that drove me. You know, when I came here at Versova, this beach was 5.5 feet of plastic. Now, if you ask me as a lawyer, I could have moved the high court, filed a writ petition, asked the judge to pass some order, affidavits would have been filed by the government and the municipality. But I told myself, why can't my two hands become the orders of the court? Why can't the mind of an individual become the order of the court? Before a government or a court order can come to your rescue, which eventually they should in a democracy, you should start moving, Shloka. And hence I started what I started. And that journey began with with a small thing, me and one 80-year-old man going to clean up who was suffering from terminal cancer. And look where we have come in 6 years. And this journey must go right up to circular economy, you see. And oceans are very interlinked to the global warming, which you talk about. You know, ocean is 71% of our planet. You can't divorce the fact that the health of the ocean is closely correlated to what will happen. Mitigation and adaptation of the environment or the land and air must closely run the mitigation and adaptation in the ocean as well.
No, Afroz, I couldn't agree with you more. And I'm so glad that you sort of, you know, talk about the need to build that circular economy, like you said. Mm-hmm. Can you tell me a little bit more about, you know, how we get to a zero waste economy? There must be so many people here today who are thinking about, you know, how they can be better citizens like you, you know, what they can do to sort of correct for the waste that they accumulate. And, you know, how do we sort of overcome the barriers that we face right now in India when it comes to creating, you know, that circular economy or zero waste economy? What does it look like for you and how do we get there?
First of all, we must define the problem, Shloka, properly. You know, if the problem is wrongly defined, it's like asking a wrong question, you'll get a wrong answer. Circular economy at this point is falling in that bracket. It's a gray area because not many of us understand. We think circular economy means waste management at times. See, reduction of garbage is the key. Once you survive on the planet, your generation of garbage, especially garbage which are non-recyclable, which are not biodegradable, are something which concerns the health of the planet. Having said that, there are two aspects to it, Shloka. One is to work on a systemic level. When I say systemic level, the government must get the policies and the laws right. Then the enforcement has to be proper. Then the companies, corporates, people who are stakeholders, who are producing plastic, who are producing materials which generate garbage, they will have to come all on board. That's on a systemic level. Then on an individual level, you wear a dual hat. Sometimes I go into the system. In the evening, I'm back from the system. I'm in my small family unit. And once I'm in the family, I should start taking steps. You know, to take you to some small tips at home, figure it out. Why are you generating this garbage? Take a check box. Figure out what you buy. Why do you buy? You see, the production and consumption of human beings have created, to top it with the 7 billion people up. So it's a scary situation. And, you know, a lot of people talk about IPCC report, global warming. I take the argument on the other side. I tell them, even if there was no IPCC report, even there was no fear of global warming, don't you think you should live responsibly on this planet? Don't you live responsibly with your family? Don't you live responsibly with your mother, your brothers, sisters, your wife, your partners? Why don't we do that with Mother Nature? Mother Nature has an ecosystem, and that ecosystem has many, many species. You can't trouble them. Your rights cannot go into the zone of their rights where they're enjoying it. And that's the problem, Shloka. Circular economy basically is to reduce the garbage. And if you have reduced it, please handle it properly. Unfortunately, in India at this point of time, Shloka, there is no circular economy policy or an act in place. As a lawyer, I must tell you, there's nothing. I mean, hopefully we'll work in 2-3 years and come in. There's no act, no policy. So now it's all use and throw culture. You go to a mall, pick up you like a milk pouch, take it up and throw it wherever you want. Sometimes it lands in the landfill, sometimes in your garbage bin, stays for long, and then sometimes into the ocean. So we'll have to work. My work involves that, you know, where we go out to people, especially in these lower strata, economic strata, you know, where there is a lot of generation of garbage. We talk to them, how do we get it down? And they are the one who are bearing the brunt of global warming. You know, their houses are located near rivers, their houses are located near the edge of the ocean and all that stuff. So to create some kind of leadership from there is the key. You know, we have too many followers, Shloka, in this world. We all want to follow. Some leader rises up and we say, come on. Like Prime Minister Modi, we say, oh God, he's a great leader. Whatever he says, we follow. I urge people up, we need to create more leaders at the ground, you know. And my work entails that if a 12-year-old boy or a girl at River Mithi can understand the significance of that river and saying that the river is a part of my life, our problems will get mitigated automatically. So that's the key for circular economy. People need to work at systemic level and individual level, Shloka.
No, I love that response, Afroz. You're such a passionate sort of advocate for, you know, as I said, being responsible citizens. I just wish we could replicate you a million times over.
But you also work a lot, Shloka, on other fronts. Tata Trust is doing some great work on all these aspects. You know, I was I'd had the privilege to go through some documents and stuff like that.
Thank you for saying that, Afroz. We were doing our best, of course. We were one of the first philanthropies to really sort of pick up the charge of sustainability and climate change, you know, almost 4 years ago now. I think we saw the writing on the wall quite early on. And actually, one of the things that we've done in the interim is incubate an entity called the India Climate Collaborative, which I also lead. And that really looks to sort of increase climate ambition in the country. So it's the first ever collaborative between business and philanthropic leaders on climate action in India. And one of the things, of course, that we're really, really keenly focused on is building coastal resilience.
Absolutely.
Especially for, you know, coastal communities, given sort of increasing climate impacts, we're really facing, you know, a world that, I mean, just to give you an example, in the last 10 to 20 years, we've seen a huge increase in coastal hazards, from storms to tsunamis, typhoons, flooding. And I think the impacts of that is so much more serious today than it would have been 50 years ago, because not just are the events bigger, but there's so many more people living along the coastal zone.
Yeah.
I think today, according to the UN, 40% of the world's population lives within 100 kilometers of a coast. So how do we sort of build in those warning systems, those, you know, resilience measures to make sure that these, you know, populations that are really vulnerable are not going to suffer the consequences of climate impacts as we go forward. So that's been a huge portion of, you know, the work that we're trying to do right now.
That's so great to hear, you know. And as you rightly said, Shloka, collaboration is the key, you know. You know, and there's a saying in English, birds of a feather flock together. People people who really want to, who feel strongly about climate change, pollution problem in ocean and the rivers going, you know, dirty, I think we should all must gang up, you know, collaboration. To put it politely, we must all collaborate and come forward and make sure that the planet is left in a safer hand. You know, as a lawyer, I must tell you, we talk about intergenerational equity and trust, you know, which Prime Minister Modi spoke the other day at New York. He holds this planet Earth in trust for others, the future generation. We cannot betray their trust, and we cannot give them a worse Earth than what we are. The adults have messed it up, and surprisingly, it's the younger generation who are rising up, Shloka, and telling us that we'll make the change. You know, to give you one small example, Shloka, I have these small programs running in the community. I had told one eight-year-old girl, she came up to me, and there were a lot of biscuit packets, you know, they're multi-layer, cannot be recycled in the ocean. I said, can you buy biscuits from the local bakery? After 2 weeks, she turned back and she said, she got the pictures and she showed it to me. She said, see, I've got the packaging out. Now, these are the leadership you're looking at. If an eight-year-old girl can make that change, how difficult it is. Like today, now, just 5 minutes back, I put a video out on social media of how I buy my tea leaves. Okay. Yeah. We have tea leaves in bulk packaging, and it is sold by the very companies who sell tea in small packets. Like, to shift over to bulk packaging, half your problem gets evaporated on carbon footprint and generation of garbage. So that's key, taking those small steps at individual level. And then becoming like a good voter, please vote people who think about climate, who want to do something about Mother Nature. So vote responsibly and do things, you know, rights and duties must be balanced. If you have right to vote and pay your taxes, you must fulfill your duty on this planet Earth also.
No, I think that's so well put. And in fact, you know, what you just said about sort of the need to really generate or you know, push for sort of individual action, I think it's so important. And it's actually something, of course, we're really working hard on, as I said, ourselves at the Tara Trust and at the ICC. So one thing that we're trying to do right now is, you know, distribute the ability to solve. We keep talking about how it should not be sort of just based on one stakeholder, for instance, just government, you know, that we keep looking to. So what we're trying to do, I'll give you an example, is actually develop, you know, a first of its kind climate risk atlas for India. And we're doing this with one of our partners, the Council on Energy, Environment and Water. And the idea really is, rather than focusing on a single climate impact, like let's say heat or heat as in heat stress or even a single geography, this atlas will actually look at a range of different kind of climate impacts, from floods to droughts to cyclones, even forest fires, etc. And the idea is, how do we predict that district level vulnerability across the country? And so we're hoping to really use this tool to build more resilient infrastructure to help safeguard those vulnerable communities. But more importantly, as I said, it'll do a great deal on the capacity building front, because it'll equip central, state, district level governments, as well as civil society organizations, and of course, communities and individuals like the ones that you've just described, with the skills and resources that they need to create very local and very context-specific adaptations to the impacts of climate change. And actually, this is something we're launching next month at Glasgow for COP26. And the idea, as I said, is how do we use data and information to create that enabling environment for the individuals, like, you know, the girl that you mentioned,
yeah,
so that they can keep their communities safe and healthy.
Absolutely. You're on dot there, Shloka. You put it very succinctly and very aptly. This is what is required. Creating capacities, creating individuals with capacities will lead it forward. And hopefully, you know, Ashoka, I'm basically a recluse. I don't come on television much, but when I do, I don't want to sound preachy, but my thought goes that we, as an Indian, you know, we drove the British Empire out 70 years back. those were a few freedom fighters who did it. I see no reason for all of us to do what they did. If they could send the British Empire out with all its might and energy, I mean, we could handle global warming at a, you know, global warming is a huge concept.
Yeah.
We are all affected, but at the same time, the actions must start locally. Mumbai city must take the charge. Delhi city must take the charge. People living near the ocean must take the charge. People living near the river. Now, what is happening in Mumbai, take for example, we are a city of migrants. So people come here and they say, oh, I live in UP. I live in Telangana. I'll do what I want to. I'll go back to my state. And that creates a situation in the city where, you know, it can become worse. Global warming can become a bigger problem. Pollution can become a bigger problem. And that's where the solution lies, where we should step forward. Each one of us, you know, who's listening to me, please do something for your motherland and mother country. You know, we have 168 hours in a week, 2 hours stepping out, wearing your gloves, doing something. And I'm telling you, it's the biggest dopamine kick you get. I'm a first-hand experience with people who are feeling low. Just wear your gloves and do something out here. You know, it raises your spirit. It builds up the community. It builds up the democratic structure. And you move away from complaining all the time, saying, oh my God, this is not working. That's not working. It's a positive space you move into, you know. And that's the crucial aspect, Shloka.
No, I think you've just said it so well, Afroz. You know, I keep talking about the fact that even in India, it's such a critical challenge, climate change, because we're the fifth most vulnerable country in the world. 75% of Indian districts are vulnerable to extreme climate events. I mean, honestly, that's a correlation that will impact over 700 million lives just in India alone. And so, you know, I keep, again, as I said, I keep telling people that the thing with climate change is that we may all be in the same storm, but we're not in the same boat. Like, it is going to impact countries like India so much more sort of adversely than other parts of the world. And so, like you rightly said, you know, the power is really in our hands. The tools are in our hands. We just have to literally go out there and, you know, of course, you know, do what you're doing, just throw on those gloves and do our bit.
Absolutely. In fact, you know, Shloka, somebody in the government is listening, if you're an elected representative, go right now, make a good law. Make sure that the law is enforced. It's your job, your duty. You know, we must do that. And if a corporate is listening, if you're a CEO or an MD or a chairman, start working among your employees. Fulfill your social. If I'm an individual, I must start right now. You know, we should all start doing little every week. Otherwise, you see the rut which we have landed. You know, I see so many marine species. You know, we talk about marine resilience at my beach, you know. A turtle who's got a plastic in the mouth, in the anus. I mean, you look at it, you don't know what to do with it. You cry, sit and cry. So I think all of us who are listening, start. The journey must start. Otherwise, we'll keep on debating. You know, all our conversations will happen in TV studios. And when we go back, it's back to square one.
I couldn't agree more, of course. And thank you for doing the work that you do. I really, you know, admire and applaud individuals like yourselves who are out there, literally feet on the ground, boots on the ground, day after day, doing what you're doing. And you're creating, you know, world movements. So thank you for that and all of your, you know, passion and dedication.
No, I must end this by saying thank you, Shloka, for having me. I'm a big fan of your work at Tata Trust too. And
thank you,
Economic Times, for having it. Hopefully, we'll see more of these conversations to take forward. Thanks.
Yeah, absolutely. Thank you to ET as well.
Yeah.